Live from WKRC-TV, it's the Ira Joe Fisher Show. Now, here's Ira Joe.
Oh, no, please. Thank you. Wow. Gee whiz, look at everybody that's here. Generations of people and a cute little ribbon in her hair. Look at this cute little ribbon in her hair over here, Bob. This is absolutely adorable. Anybody, where's the camera? Let's buy a camera. Somebody bring a camera with them. Oh, there we go. Isn't that pretty? Yes. Sisters on TV, isn't that great? Well, we are delighted that you are here and that you are watching. What a show do we have planned today, for heaven's sakes. We are going to meet some people with whom many of us grew up. And now, together, we all grow older, and we're going to chat about that very subject today. We have with us Glenn Ryle. Come on, let's hear it for Glenn. Yeah. Everybody's so shy. Don't be shy. And I hope you brought your rubber chickens, because Bob Shreve is here with us today, too. We have Uncle Al and Wanda Lewis. A gentleman who entertained us so very nicely on the Bob Braun Show and is now singing with the great group, the Letterman, Mark Preston, is here. And, boom, boom, we have the DeFelice Quartet. Lou Lausche, Kenny Poole, and Philip DeGreg. And there they are. Yeah, all right. Glad you are here, gentlemen. Glad you are here, ladies and gentlemen. Stay with us. We're going to take a break, and when we come back, we are going to chat with Glenn Ryle.
Just joined us and wonder what in the world is taking place. Luckily, we've been blessed with a very good day here in Cincinnati, or good so far, and we're keeping our fingers crossed that it holds out until along about 12 o'clock. People that have been kind enough, and again, I can't say thank you enough for coming out to say goodbye to the Skipper Ryle Show. Now, everybody has been wondering, everybody's been, as I pass through the crowd, wondering what's going to happen. Well, let me take just a moment to kind of remind you, or to tell you about it, if you haven't read it in the newspapers lately. I will still be at Channel 12.
Yeah. And that is the good news for us here at Channel 12. He is still with us. Ladies and gentlemen, would you welcome, please, to our program, one of my favorite people and yours too, Glenn Skipper Ryle. Hi, Glenn. Have a seat.
All right.
Look at this guy. Doesn't he look wonderful, huh? TJ, let's look at the boots here. Let's look at the boots. We never get to see these on TV. For heaven's sakes, look at those.
I made sure it was dead first.
Oh, did you? I see. Okay, all right.
I can't walk in regular shoes.
Is that right? I know you wear cowboy boots all the time.
Yes, for years.
What did you saw the little tape that was there? What was that? 19?
Yeah, it looked like Prince Valiant.
It looks great. Just as you do today. What was that? 1973?
Yes, 1973.
And the Skipper Ryle Show went from 57 to 73.
No, 56.
56.
1956. Well, I'm terrible on dates.
Well,
you may be right, but I think it was 56.
We have a number of scenes that we're going to share with you. Can we come in here really close for this one, please, Pete? Because this is given to us by one of our favorite people, too, and yours, Glenn. Our cameraman, Bob Kelly. There we go. I'm not holding this very well. Oh, it's on Bob's camera. That's why it isn't working out. There's Glenn, of course, holding one of the younger Kelly children, members of the staff here at Channel 12, and the Skipper Ryle episode from heaven knows what year. This was,
I have no idea,
20
that,
years
that
ago.
Was the weekday show.
Yeah, and then here is that little baby that you were holding now. Right here we go. There she is. Okay. Time has certainly passed for some of these people, Glenn.
All too quickly.
So many folks say to me, how's Skipper doing? Or I see him on the air. And you were such a big part of so many lives. Do you ever think about that?
No. I really don't.
Okay, well, let's get on to our next interview.
Number one, no.
No, I know what you mean.
The reason why I paused, it was...
So you're still a big part of everybody's life here.
The reason why I paused was because I really didn't have any preparations or any ideas that I was ever going to be in this business.
Yeah.
I mean, I was kicking cows in the tail and a Marine, and all of a sudden found myself in radio.
Yeah.
And then in television, it all kind of happened very quickly.
And accidentally, really.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, well, I couldn't get a job. You know, if I would go around...
Hey, that's why we're all in this life.
You know, well, Jackie was not a service wife. I was going to be a career Marine. And every time I went someplace, it was going to crash or, you know, something was going to happen.
Sure.
And so when you go to apply for a job, you know, and they ask you what kind of experience you have, and you look at them and say, I can feel strip a machine gun in the dark. And I said, well, we can't. But, and then the events just happened, and I was very, very fortunate, really.
You started in radio WMOH in Hamilton.
Hamilton, Ohio.
All right. Then you came and worked for a while at WLW.
Well, I was just on a freelance basis.
Yeah.
On the old Midwestern Hayride. Did a couple of commercials down there. Scared, silly. And then went to work as a staff announcer at WCPO.
All right. And then you came to Channel 12 in what year? Early 50s.
55.
Okay, middle 50s then. And you hosted the movie. Now listen to the things that this gentleman has done, and you're certainly aware of them. I want to tell you, you have worked as a staff announcer. You hosted Bowling for Dollars just on the other side of this wall right over here.
It was here and over there.
Oh, that's right. It was in two places.
Yeah, they had to move the entire lane.
When I started here in 1980, the bowling alley was still here. In fact, I had to set pins for the first couple of months.
Put him to work for a while.
Just to make ends meet.
That's because he came by wagon train.
And that's another thing that you did. Steve Deschler left while he was doing the weather here, went on to Chicago, and I was hired as his replacement. But there was a little bit of a lapse time between Steve.
Are you kidding? Steve Deschler left, and they said, we've got a replacement, and he's coming in. Well, usually in this business, things happen pretty quick.
Yeah.
And now I'm working, I guess, 6 and sometimes 7 days a week, and I was doing the weather, and I said, when is this new fella going to get here? And I think a month and a half or so at least went by.
Well, I was driving an old car in those days, Glenn. It took a while to get here from the state
of
Washington.
No, but the payoff was, when I finally met Ira, it was one of those things, you know, where you really kind of feel very comfortable with a guy. And you were going back to Spokane.
Yeah.
I believe.
Yeah.
And you were going from here to Chicago to catch a train.
Yeah.
And I offered to fly him to Chicago. I said, well, don't worry, I'll fly you to Chicago.
And I fainted.
And I looked at him, and he had the strangest look about him, and I said, what did he say was wrong? And then I found out that, no way he is going to get off the ground.
I don't even like to talk about that subject, for heaven's sake. So you were very kind to me, and one of the first memories I have here at Channel 12 is you extending that kindness, teaching me the ropes here, and it was so much fun. Let's talk about the Skipper Ryle show. How did it come to be? And it seems to me so often in this business, we do sort of just wing things, and it was the case with your
it
show as well?
Certainly was.
Yeah.
In fact, the man you had on the show yesterday, Len Gurion.
There's the skipper right there.
You people don't know what this puts me through. I don't like to look back. I don't save pictures and, you know, stuff like that. But the man you had on the day, Tom Tenenfeld was working the Skipper Ryle show, and... directed, what is that?
This is a certificate that you get, right? You become a first mate of the Skipper Ryle Club.
Yeah, I kept trying to get some of the mothers as first mates, but Jackie complained. But, no, it was. It was strictly by accident. I was in KRC. I was doing movies. I was doing early morning, at times, news.
Uh-huh.
And Len Gurion and the late David Taft. That's when the time change came about, if any of you remember about that. And it always left some gaps in programming.
Yeah.
And he said, we need a Saturday filler. This was like on a Monday. And they said, we'd like for you to do a children's show starting Saturday. And at that time, I had a couple of kids that I didn't know whether I was going to live, you know, long enough. I was in and out as a father.
Yeah.
And I said, a children's show? And I thought, oh, my heavens.
Well, and then it went on to become an 18-year-long enterprise and won the hearts of so many children and children who became adults down through the years. I want to show you an example of the dignity that Glenn Ryle always takes to his job. We want have a little item here that we wanted to share with you while Glenn is sitting here. This is something you remember.
Hello. to Glenn's Den. Starring Glenn Ryle.
I'd sure like to turn back the pages of time and start the whole doggone thing again. It would be a lot of fun.
Oops, oops.
Carl Dilhoff is no longer going to be
there. One of our engineers and friends, Carl Dilhoff, has saved some of these clandestine tapes of Glenn down through the
that
years.
That was Carl's horse.
He knew
Carl
right away who
saddle,
did it.
And I think Carl went out and loosened a cinch on that tape.
We have Carl to thank. Glenn, it's so much fun to have you here, and we're going to spend the entire hour with some good friends of yours and mine, and you're going to stick around, and we'll chat about things down through the years, because coming up next is a guy that has literally kept us in stitches down through the years. We're going to chat with Bob Shreve when we come back.
Warm 98. Warm 98. Cincinnati's soft rock.
It's morning, and to start your day off right, you need to know what's going on in the tri-state and the rest of the world. There's no better way than by watching the Eyewitness 12 News Morning Report with Kit Andrews and Glenn Ryle, and ABC's World News This Morning with Steve Bell and Kathleen Sullivan every weekday morning at 6. In 60 minutes, you get a complete blend of local and national news, the information you need at the time you need it. The Eyewitness 12 News Morning Report and ABC's World News This Morning, weekdays at 6 on WKRC Channel 12.
Come out, listen on the air. Up there, down there, fairies everywhere. Oh, hark, oh, hear, can't you hear the tune? Fairy, fairy, pipers underneath a silver moon. But if you doubt that this can be, and a question of what I say, you'll never hear the melody.
Tape. That was Bob Shreve, and now here he is joining us on our show. Ladies and gentlemen, Bob Shreve.
As chairwoman of the reception committee, I welcome you with open arms.
Thank you.
Hi, Bob.
Ira Joe.
How are you?
Yeah, well, I as soon as my eyes open, I'll feel a...
Bob's not real happy about being here this early.
No, the police and the...
That's right.
Yesterday it was a trio. Today they got another $10 out of the guy, right?
Yes, they're just like rabbits
the
over
union,
there.
The union, beautiful.
Please have a seat.
Could we sit down? I've been up since about 3:30.
Come on, this couch is rented.
Don't
we got to get a lot of use out of it
here. Is
this
for me?
Very good.
Again.
Don't do that.
The lady just said, I wish I could do that. Oh, you can.
This is weird, you being up this time of day.
It is, yeah.
And it was in this very studio for years
right?
and years. Past Prime Playhouse.
Right.
What?
I just happened to think of something. No, the studio was over in that corner.
Yep.
Right?
Yes, it was.
Like for 10 years, I think.
Yeah.
And,
In fact, the wall is still green. We have it covered up and spent a long time
doing it. A couple of cream pies spliced up on the side there. But if that were true now, I'd probably be doing my show from the men's room or something. I don't know, because this is a huge studio, and it's beautiful.
Well, it has a huge host on this show, so we had to have some room here to accommodate that guy. See, that's what the deal was.
But no, I used to...
Why are you touching me?
Well, you're nice and warm, and my hands are like...
You two want to be alone? Kill the lights.
But,
I think we should leave.
I used to
Hold
do
on.
That.
You better do a little begging your pardon.
I'm sorry.
The Duke dropped by. Isn't that great?
I used to do that morning stint. Oh, yes.
You've done a lot of things.
Yes.
And I discovered geez, we've been friends for 6 years, Bob, but I discovered you started 1936, 50 years ago, WOWO Radio in Fort Wayne, Indiana. And you worked with a guy I remember when I was a boy watching on TV, Herb Schreiner.
He was a Fort Wayne boy,
yep.
Right? And
what brought you to Cincinnati?
Well, years and years ago, by listening to WOW Radio and hearing a couple people, Grace and Eddie Albert,
mm-hmm.
who then something happened, then he married Margo, but Eddie Albert went on to the coast and made a big thing there.
Yes,
I used to listen to, yes, that was the picture, I've forgotten what year it was, but a comedian then, or tried to be. And listening to people like Bert Farber from the Hotel, the Restaurant Continental in the Hotel Netherland Plaza, and listening to, I think, Rosemary or Betty Clooney on Moon River, in different shows, I would give my right arm to make the staff of WLW. That was my one great ambition in life. So after I went in the Navy in 1942, came out in 46, I came down and auditioned at LW, and finally, after about 18 trips down here in August of 48, they took me on.
Isn't that great? And you were hired as a singer.
Right.
I mean,
had a beautiful voice.
Well,
no, really.
I'm sure you do. Yeah, you have a beautiful voice now. What do you say had? You didn't turn it in. You still have it, huh?
Well, it's getting a little rusty, but... So finally, I made it, and it was a very happy day, and I thought, this is it. I'd go no further. I've made WLW, now I'm seven. And then I did 1 year at your former station in New York.
Yeah.
WABC-TV for 8 months or something like that.
We don't stay at that place long. Have you noticed that, Bob?
Yeah.
We go up there and then we leave. What is the deal?
I don't know. Is it?
And they didn't even ask me to sing. You know, I was really put out about that.
So, but that was the whole thing, and I enjoyed it. But after being part of the inspiration up in Fort Wayne and singing with a piano player, a guitar player, whatever, when I came to WLW, I think the first show I had, Bert Farber was the director of the orchestra. And after hearing this guy on radio for so many years, you can imagine what a thrill to be able to sing with a group of 30 musicians.
Oh, I bet.
Fiddles and horns and the whole thing there.
Well, we have an example of the fine work that you did. I want to show you this wonderful album that Bob recorded. And here's Bob doing his thing. Good old Bob doing his thing.
Yes, by the way, I sold 5 of those.
They'll be available in the lobby.
The guy's going to ask me at the door when you go out there.
You're collecting them.
Yeah.
You were involved with the very first broadcast from Cincinnati to NBC, which was on the network, and Betty Clooney was on the show, and you did a bit over on the bridge, didn't you?
Suspension bridge,
yeah.
Yes, walking across there with the hat pulled down and the collar turned up. Brother, Can You Spare a Dime?
Yes, a great 30s depression song.
But that was the first... network feed out of Cincinnati, yes.
We have a couple of times referred to people that have sat here this week on this couch, Bob, as legends. You two both certainly qualify for that appellation. Do you agree that you qualify as a legend? Do you ever think about that?
Yes. Somebody said one time, especially doing the all-night thing, a legend who has become a tradition.
Oh, wonderful.
Never knew what that meant. But it sounded good, and I'll use that.
Well, I think it qualifies. You've touched so many people just by being a part of our lives and us having the good fortune to watch you on television. Television is an odd medium, and we were talking today, there are people who still say it'll never fly, this TV business.
I have a mother who is 97 years old, still waiting for me to get honest work. And we got her a TV set, and she, you know, still thinks it won't last.
Well, more than any other medium, we do find ourselves in the homes and automobiles, and if we are lucky, and you two certainly qualify for this, in the hearts of the people who turn that dial. And we're so glad to have you here, Bob, and Glenn, of course. Stick around. There's more to come, because when we take this break, we will meet people you already know. Hal and Wanda Lewis. Don't go away.
Magic potion is going to turn you... Captain Windy, into Toad!
Well, Captain Windy, looks as if now we're going to be Uncle Toad and Captain Frog.
I don't think that's the least bit funny.
Hey, look at us, kid! Oh, hey! The wing just came! came off. The wing gear came off. Whoa! Hang on! Hold on to the airplane!
Well, as you have already noticed, that we have been sharing with you the president's departure from Washington to go to Reykjavik for the pre-summit with Mikhail Gorbachev, the Soviet leader. We are back live now here on our program, and we would like to introduce to you two people that have meant so very much to the city of Cincinnati, especially to our childhood. They are dear friends of yours and mine, ladies and gentlemen, Al and Wanda Lewis.
Oh, hey.
We're going to do this, I better do this first as Uncle Al.
Yes.
So then I have to put this hat on, right, kids? Okay.
All generations, of course.
Pick up the sketch pad.
All right.
And I'll do a little song as Uncle Al, because later I'm going to come back as Al Lewis.
Okay.
Here's a little poem that was written by A. Milne, and the kids always enjoyed it when we did the Uncle Al show. And I'll try to sing it while Wanda does a little drawing. Little boy kneels at the foot of the bed. Droops on his little hands, little gold head. Hush, hush, whisper who dares. Christopher Robin is saying his prayers. Now God bless Daddy, I know that's right. Wasn't it fun in a tub tonight? The cold so cold and the hot so hot. God bless my Nanny. I quite forgot. If I open my fingers a little bit more, I can see Nanny's dressing gown on the door. It's a beautiful blue, but it hasn't a hood. Now God bless my Nanny. And make her good. Now mine has a hood and I lie in bed. I pull the hood right over my head. I close my eyes and I curl up small. And nobody knows I'm there at all. Thank you, God, for a lovely day. And what was the other I had to say? I've said bless Daddy, so what can it be? Oh, now I remember it. God bless me. Little boy kneels at the foot of the bed. Droops on his little hands, little gold head. Hush, hush, whisper who dares. Christopher Robin is saying his prayers. Thank you.
Come sit down. Al and Wanda Lewis, ladies and gentlemen.
Hey, Al.
Wanda. Thank you.
Good to have you here. What we're going to do, we're going to take a break. We're going to chat with Alawanda when we come back. Don't you dare leave us.
It's now the Kroger brand sale.
Wow.
Save 10 to 20% compared to national brands.
Wow.
And Kroger guarantees you'll be satisfied every time.
Mm.
Kroger whole kernel or cream style corn, 3 for $1. Kroger cut or French style green beans, 3 for $1. And Kroger sweet peas, 3 cans for $1.
Yeah.
Feel the difference. Go Krogery.
Ah, yeah, the DeFelice Quartet. Ladies and gentlemen, we have just been entertained by and now joined here on our sofa, Al and Wanda Lewis, and we are so delighted to have you here on our program. We're talking about the history of which you are both such a large part, the history of Cincinnati television. How does it feel now as you look back on these careers of yours to be regarded in the way you are regarded?
It has been 37 years of fun, gaiety, and laughter.
Uh-huh.
Because anytime you can make children happy...
and money. Money, Shreve says.
We got babysitting fees.
Oh, right.
Yes.
Dollar now. You're pouring out a lot of knees on a pair of pants, I'll tell you.
It was a great 37 years, because anytime you can make children laugh, teach them how to cross the street carefully, good eating, music, rhythm, I think I've accomplished, we have.
You know, in the Fisher household, when we first moved here, I remember we did a benefit that you were chairman of one time, Alan, and I went home and was talking with my little boys, Josh and Shelby, and they were sort of half paying attention. We were having a conversation, and I mentioned that Uncle Al was there, and my son Josh stopped in whatever he was doing. I think he dropped an object and said, "You touched Uncle Al?" I'll never forget that. That's something that really has impressed him. And so believe me, I used to be a faithful viewer of the program too. Captain Windy, Uncle Al, Magic Town.
You should have been doing what I was doing. I was doing a Skip Around show, and Jackie took the kids, my kids, up to see Al. You know, he came back raving about it, you know.
Those were the days when Wanda used to fly like Supergirl.
Oh, yeah.
Yes, remember? Yeah. But now we can't do that because she runs like heck and she can't take off.
So. You're using my lines again.
No, you haven't said very much, Wanda. Hop right in here. You worked with such greats as Len Gorian and with Paul Dixon. We were talking about that yesterday. What do you remember when you think back on these memories?
Well, I think at the time Al and I first came to town, we'd just been married, and they were putting together the shows on WCPO, getting ready to go on the air. Al was our director at the time, was getting ready to do a show. Paul Dixon was here. He had a disc jockey show on radio, very successful, and they wanted to put him on television. So it was the idea, what do you do while the record's playing? They also, how about pantomiming? So they did that. And, well, what about the songs that you can't pantomime? Well, you can do a drawing. So I happened to be in the studio that day, and Al ran out, got a drawing board for me, and I did a short sketch. And
you both met at the Cleveland Institute of Art.
Yes.
I mean, it's not like you just are, you know, casual doodlers. You people are artistes.
Would you believe the first time I met her was in life class?
Is that right?
And she thought that life class at that time was plants and flowers.
You're telling all my secrets.
What was it, Wanda? What was life class?
Yeah, it was life class.
Class. Anatomy.
Anatomy.
Anatomy. Mm-hmm. Art was very lovely. Nice.
Naked people.
That's what you're saying. That's what I thought we were relating to, Glenn. Thank you.
Uncle Al couldn't say that, right.
That's what we need is an interpreter. Well, no. Al, we have, of course, known you as Uncle Al, and you have entertained us so wonderfully down through the years, us as children. How about being Al Lewis and performing for us with the accordion? Would you do that?
I would love it.
Al Lewis, ladies and gentlemen, and the accordion.
Just happened to have. Now, if I can remember how to get into it.
Yeah.
There you are.
Hope you don't get up.
This is funny, but somebody was fooling around with my strap.
Oh, no. All right.
Oh, it works. Let's face it, there are certain things that are pure Cincinnati. Chili, Grater's Ice Cream, Mount Adams, Fountain Square, the Bengals. And our radio show's a lot like that. We've been here a long time, and people know they can depend on us, and they seem to like us.
Chatted with some cast members from the Bob Braun show, and everybody who was able to make it was here for those first couple of shows. Some people weren't able to make it until today. We are rectifying that right now, ladies and gentlemen. Would you welcome, please, currently with the Letterman, and he used to be with the Bob Braun show, Mr. Mark Preston.
Mark. Go ahead.
You can tell when you open the door You can tell when there's love in a home. Every table and chair seems to smile. Do come in, come and stay for a while. You almost feel you've been there once before, by the shine and the glow of the room and the clock seems to chime. Come again anytime. You'll be welcome wherever you roam. You can tell when there's love in a home. Been there once before, by the shine and the glow of the room, and the clock seems to chime. Come again anytime, you'll be welcome wherever you roam. You can tell, you can tell, you can tell when there's love in.
Wonderful, Mark. Wonderful.
Good to be here. Thank you.
Please have a seat.
Hello, everybody. Oh, yeah.
Does that sound wonderful or what?
How are you, sir? Nice boots.
Nice boots yourself.
Thank you.
For heaven's sakes. How tall are you? 8 feet?
6'2", 6'3", somewhere near. I really don't know.
Right, for heaven's sakes. But you were higher than rent. Listen. Now, you gave me a little look there at the end of the song, like, ooh, we got through that. That was absolutely beautiful. This is not a good time of day for singing?
Oh, no, this is fine. Okay. This is fine. It went very well.
I thought it went extremely well.
It was okay.
Aren't they wonderful?
That's a good band.
Oh, they're wonderful. Oh, yeah. You were discovered by Tennessee Ernie Ford, who told Bob Braun about you.
Yes, exactly. At the time on Bob's show, Martha White was a sponsor, and Ernie is their national spokesman. And so Ern came into town, and at that time his manager was my manager, and Bob said, Randy Hamilton had just left the show and was doing Texas or something, and Bob said, do you have any singers that you know of? And Ernie said, I got the kid for you right now. He's in Vegas and right now doing a show, but we'll see if we can get him in. And so I came in and did an audition, and that's where I met Tony of the Letterman, Tony Butala.
Sure.
And so as a result of that initial meeting in 1980 is why I have the job with the Letterman now.
Isn't it strange how so many accidents happen for the best? You were in the right place at the right time. You'd won an Air Force talent competition.
1975, yes. I was stationed in Omaha, Nebraska, and the Commander-in-Chief of Strategic Air Command at the time was General Russell Doherty. And during World War II, Ernie Ford was his navigator on B-29s, and so Russ had me sing for a party for Ford, and that's how all that started.
I want to know something, Mark. Was your hair like that when you were in the Air Force?
No, absolutely not.
I didn't think
not.
So. Mine, they wouldn't let me do that.
That was
either.
Much longer than this.
Now, you've been back with the Letterman a number of times. Most recently, you sang at opening day.
Yes, we did opening day, which was quite a thrill for us. And then we just did Tony Perez Day when Tony said bye-bye. And then I've sung it a couple times alone, but mainly with the Letterman. Now, we were with the Symphony at Music Hall last June, a year ago June, not this past summer, and we were at the Islands for the Spiral Sweeps
Spiral
Beauty
Spring
Pageant
States,
or something.
Yeah.
Yes, we emceed that and performed there, too. So hopefully we'll be back for that every year. I think they're going to have us back.
Well, you know, Mark, when you come back, this would be a show that would be awfully nice to appear on.
Hey, we're ready to do
it,
Ira. We're ready to do it.
We're trying to give Dee some work, and, you know, so we're just hoping this will all work out and everything. Where are the Letterman at the moment?
Right now, we just, we were in Altoona, Pennsylvania yesterday. Well, it came home
it's
yesterday.
It's a great place to make music, Altoona.
Yeah, oh, yeah. So there's a beautiful shrine mosque there for the benefit of the police in Pennsylvania, so we're pretty safe driving through Pennsylvania.
All right.
But then we go to Scranton tomorrow, and then we're in Ligonier on Saturday in Greenville, Ohio on Sunday, and then we're going out to Los Angeles, and then we have a five-day run of Plymouth, Indiana, Boca Raton, Florida, Bloomington, Minnesota, Seattle, Washington, San Diego, and Hawaii.
See, they're all right close together. That doesn't involve any traveling.
None at all.
We're glad you're here, Mark. We're going to take a break, and we'll be right back. Stay with us. Wait a minute now. We have not hit all of the old TV stars. We have a real old TV
thank
star.
You. Thank you.
No, I mean, we have all these young people up here. We're talking old TV stars.
Old
Laura Soller is here. We used to do PM Magazine together. One of the oldest.
Laura.
And Laura is in town to make a special appearance next week right here on our program, and she will be indeed doing that. We want to bring back some really old stars. We have an old friend of Bob's who's here.
Chicky,
Chicky a little bit.
Hey, Bob. Everybody wants to see Chicky a little longer.
All right. You asked for it. That's about as long as it's
going to Listen. What was that? Glenn Ryle, Mark Preston, Alawanda Lewis, Bob Shreve, and of course Joycey's here. We are all now, thank you for being here. Going to learn how to do the hokey pokey now.
Put your right hand in, you take your right hand out. Put your right hand in, and you shake it all about. You do the hokey pokey, and you turn yourself around. And that's what it's all about. Put your left hand in, you take your left hand out. Put your left hand in, and you shake it all around. You do the hokey-pokey, and you turn yourself around. And that's what it's all about.
Jump, jump.
Put your hands down, and you take your hands down. Put your hands down, and you shake it all around.
The Ira Joe Fisher Show. Stay at the Hyatt Regency, Cincinnati, downtown's newest luxury hotel. Transportation provided by Washington Limousine Service.
Piano courtesy of Willis Music Company. ¶¶